put the few things in decoding refractive surprises. So we have got six lectures. Dr. Rohit Shetty is in place of Rohit Shetty. Your name? Dr. Vaitish is talking about Opscan versus Pentacam versus Galilee, which is the best machine to have in your practice. Then I'll be talking about Presbarn in the later stage. The second speaker will be Dr. Chinnappa, who will be talking about the best options for presbyopia in terms of IOL platform. Then followed by Dr. Hari Prasad will be talking about PRK, LASIK versus SMILE, which is better. Then Dr. Satyamurthy will be talking about the CXL and accelerated CXL in typical and atypical scenarios. Followed by Dr. Sunil Ganekal will be talking about ICL versus IPCL, which one to go about that. In the end, I will be winding up with the Presbyon. So over to Dr. Vaitish for his talk on Opscan versus Pentacam versus Galilee.
Dr. Vaitish. Thank you, Dr. Kudlu, for the introduction. So we'll be discussing upon the topic of Opscan versus Pentacam versus Galilee. So I do not have any financial disclosures on this topic. So we have the privilege of having multiple such devices in our hospital in Narayan Netralaya, including Opscan, Pentacam, Galilee and Cirrus, and a few more devices which are also available. So we have been able to study the devices in detail and compare in between them so that we'll be able to arrive at a better conclusion of which is better for which scenario. And the topic that we'll be discussing will be on a broad overview of four points: the evolution of these devices or technologies, the unique selling proposition or the USP of these devices, and the precision and accuracy of these devices, and followed by a summary. So when we consider evolution of these devices, starting from the earliest reflection based systems which came as Jawal Shields or Bausch & Lomb keratometers, until the latest ones which we have are the OCT based Cassia and MS39 devices which are available. So in between we have these devices which are slit scanning or and Placido based plus Scheimpflug and Placido combination devices, which include Opscan, Pentacam, Galilee and Cirrus. So since we have been doing studies on a lot of these devices in combination, so we'll be presenting those details of that as well, so we'll have a better understanding. And if you look at in general, all these topographers were designed to generate one entity in the beginning, which was just the keratometry, which is the steep and the flat keratometry. It could be either in the vertical, horizontal meridian or oblique meridians, but this is how it all started. But if you look at the earliest devices which came in, the Placido ones, this device is not to show how a Placido looks, but if you carefully look, there's a central hole in the Placido, which is the actual area through which the actual cornea of the patient is either seen when you do a manual Placido or when you have an automated Placido, as in a VKG or an Opscan. What you would have is the center part of the cornea is actually not imaged. Since the central part is used as an aperture to view the cornea on which the Placido is reflected upon, so the central part of the cornea, the central 2 to 2.5 millimeters, is actually not measured in a purely Placido based system, which is one disadvantage. Whereas if you look at in a slit scanning system, when slit scanning came up, if you look at these slit scans which are projected onto the cornea in the vertical plane, both from the left and the right, if you see in the right, in the extreme peripheries, if you see the number of slits that are there are lesser. As you come towards the center, the number of slits that are coinciding are higher. So which means that your data accuracy is higher in the center compared to the periphery. So if you look at the Placido, in the center part of the cornea, the accuracy was lesser. As you come towards these, the next generation, the slit scanning based, your central cornea is imaged better than the periphery. And when you come to this Placido and slit scanning based system, the Opscan is a primary, is a classical example, wherein in the first version of the Opscan, we had only a slit scanning system. Then it was combined with the Placido and Opscan 2, and the latest one with Bausch & Lomb Opscan 2Z has a Hartmann-Shack aborometer as well. And if you look at the other next generation of the topographers, which is a Scheimpflug, this also works on a slit scanning based system, as in it measures both the anterior and the posterior cornea, because Placido can measure only the anterior part, whereas a slit is required to measure the anterior and the posterior cornea together. But if you look at how these slits are projected, The slits are projected in such a way that as you go from center to periphery, the number of data points you get is maximum in the center 2 to 3 millimeter. Because we all know as cornea surgeons or refractive surgeons, the patient is 90% of the times going to see from the central part of the cornea, central 2 millimeter. So if you have a device that measures more from the central cornea, more data points, the better is your imaging or the better is the reproducibility and accuracy of the device. So as you go from the center to periphery, you see the number of data points measured gradually becomes lesser. So starting with the Placido, where you have nothing in the center, to a slit scan which has something in the center, to a Shine Plug which has everything only in the center, these devices have evolved in this way. And in Shine Plug devices, we have the primary classical ones, Pentacam, Cirrus and Galilee. And Pentacam, when it is purely a Shine Plug device alone, Cirrus and Galilee have incorporated a Placido as well. And in Galilee, you see there are two Shine Plug cameras along with the Placido camera. So we'll be discussing how this has helped these devices to evolve in some ways. So the next part is the USP of these individual devices, as in what is the speciality of that? When you say, Virat Kohli is a batsman and Bumrah is a bowler, so each device has something specific about it. Doesn't go on to say who is more important to the team, whether Kohli or Bumrah, but all in combination will help the patient or the team. So if you look at OPSCAN, the primary purposes with which OPSCAN is being used currently, or the way in which it evolved, was the initial diagnostic criteria for keratoconus came through from OPSCAN, or the Rabinowitz works on OPSCAN. And at present, it is being used for refractive screening plus a white-to-white calculation. So if you look at the actual images, what it shows you, it gives you the primary four maps. And based on these indices, you have several criteria classified, which are currently not being used because keratoconus diagnosis, and it's been an evolution with the newer devices that are coming in. But all these criteria are still being employed by the OPSCAN device for detection and screening of keratoconus. And with the latest advent of OPSCAN 2Z and its incorporation with Bausch & Lomb, you have an OPSCAN which is used for topography, which is shifted, which is exported to the Tineo device for wavefront optimized. And when you have an advanced deverometer which is incorporated with this, which is iWave, you can also do wavefront guided treatments. So among the three devices that we discuss, OPSCAN, Pentacam and Galilee, OPSCAN is the only device which is linked to an excimer device which can actually do a wavefront optimized or a wavefront guided treatment, so which are not available to the other devices. When you look at Pentacam, the unique selling propositions of this device is primarily for a decision for a premium IOL, for a cataract preoperative screening which is not possible with OPSCAN, and it also gives you in addition the cataract grading and a holiday EKR map, because it can measure, if you look at this map, it can actually give you multiple more keratometric variables from the central part of the cornea, because we saw in Shine Plug devices, we have maximum representation of the center. So in post-LASIK eyes, post-hyperopic LASIK eyes, post-smile eyes, and all these places where you have alteration of the anterior to posterior curvature changes, in all these places, your Pentacam is going to give you a better keratometric representation for your IOL power. And if you look at these maps, which is a unique map available only with Pentacam, apart from knowing the keratometry, which was the initial purpose of the devices, which is at the 3.5 millimeter zone alone, it can give you keratometry at each and every zone. If you look at this map, it can show you the keratometric values from the 1 millimeter zone to the 7 millimeter zone, and the axis and the magnitude of astigmatism at each level. So if you find a patient has, an astigmatism of 0.5 at 4.5 millimeter zone, you are planning a toric IOL for that patient. Only if his astigmatism is similar across all ranges of pupil size, you are going to have a good outcome. If you are having a patient with, say, 4 millimeter pupil zone, you are having an astigmatism of 2 diopters, for which you are planning a toric IOL, say, T3 or T4. And for 4 millimeter pupil size, he's corrected. But for 2 millimeter pupil size, if his astigmatism is only 1 diopter, he's overcorrected. And when he goes to a mesopic pupil light in an evening time when he's having meal at a restaurant reading the menu, his pupil size is going to be 6 millimeter. And if his IOL power, if his amount of toricity required at that range is, say, 4 diopters, if there is a variation in the astigmatism between the different zones of the cornea, he's not going to be an ideal candidate for your premium IOLs. So if you find in your EKR maps that the keratometric distribution follows a single peak and your zonal standard deviation is less than 1 at the 4.5 millimeter zone, this is a criteria that people commonly use for premium IOL selections. This is not available with Galilee and OPSCAN. If you look at a similar map where the zonal keratometric deviation is much more than 1 diopter, you find that the keratometric distribution of the central part of the cornea is a large range. So these patients will have a 0.5 diopters of toricity at the 1 millimeter zone and 3 diopters of astigmatism at the 5 millimeter zone. So these patients are not suitable for a toric IOL. And when you come to Galilee, the unique features that we have here are, apart from what Pentacam can do, in addition, it can give you a corneal wavefront analysis, which cannot be done by a Pentacam. So what corneal wavefront analysis means, these parts are available with the general devices. Even OPSCAN and Pentacam will give you these maps and these indices. But if you look at what In addition, your Galilee can do is one is like pentagam, it can give you when you feed in the axial link powers, it has its own incorporated IOL formulae with which you can get the IOL powers done. And in addition, if you look at a normal topographic cylinder, if we have a patient, say, who has a two-diopter cylinder at 90 degrees, all the two diopters that the cornea shows as cylinder is not a lower order aberration alone. It's a combination of higher order aberrations as plus lower order aberrations. So you can have either a patient, most 90% of the population will have, say, if two diopters of cylinder, 1.9 diopters will be a pure astigmatism and 0.1% will be secondary astigmatism, coma and other profiles. But if you have another patient who has a very high level of coma, you will not be able to differentiate in your pentagam or off scan whether that corneal cylinder is a comatic corneal cylinder or a pure astigmatism. So these are helpful when you come across topo-guided PRK plannings or such plannings where you have a higher order aberration in combination with a cylinder, which your Galilee will be able to delineate. And the other iMetrics software of Galilee is good enough to be able to provide automated white-to-white values, which does not come out from your pentagam, whereas it gives an iMetrics software is available in your off scan, which can give you your white-to-white. And if you look at, so these things can be used for planning your ICL surgeries, and even you can simulate a LASIK flap and see based on the white-to-white where exactly your LASIK flap will fall. If you have a keratoplasty that you are planning for a 8mm graft, where will be the position of your sutures and with respect to the limbus can be found preoperatively. And let us come to the precision and accuracy. Before many people understand what we are going to discuss about precision and accuracy, I'll give you a short background. If you look at this, every keratoconus surgeon who is practicing will know, if this map is taken today and this map in the center is taken previous year, if you find that there is a 0.9 diopters of change in the steep meridian of keratometric values, everybody would jump on to say this is progressing. But if you actually look at what this is, that both these scans are done on the same day. I just labeled it today's date because for ease of understanding, but these are done on the same days, but this is not because this is not an actual progression, but it is a difference in the repeatability of the device. So this is what constitutes to a precision of a device. If you look at accuracy, if the same patient undergoes a scan in two different devices, and based on which he has two different ICL sizes or two different IOL powers or two different any other values which are derived from the device, then that questions the accuracy of the device. So when OPSCAN will give you 12.6 ICL size for the patient, and for the same patient, pentagam will give you 13.2 ICL size based on the ACD and the white-to-white. So you have to find out what is the accuracy of the device. So for that, we have published a lot of papers, so this paper has primarily compared between these five devices, pentagam, OPSCAN, Cirrus, Corvus, and ultrasonic pachymetry for their repeatability for keratometry, AC depth, thinnest corneal thickness, and central corneal thickness, for repeatability and agreement between these devices. So this is not to scare you all showing a complex stat software, but if you look at just this third column, if you find that this OPSCAN is a device which has the least repeatability for all the measurements as to keratometry, AC depth, TCT. That is, you do once you measure and you do the same measurement again, OPSCAN will have the maximum variability compared to your pentagam and Galilee. This is in normalize. And if you look at how they compare between the devices, you will be able to find that OPSCAN in most cases compared to pentagam or Cirrus or Galilee, it overestimates the steep keratometry and underestimates the flat keratometry. In essence, it actually exaggerates the amount of astigmatism that the patient has, and it underestimates the corneal thickness and the AC depth. And this has to be kept in mind when you are planning surgeries based on these devices. And Cirrus is not the topic of discussion today, but when you compare the corneal thickness measurement, you find that in order of, so if your ultrasonic pachymetry gives the highest pachymetry for every cornea you measure, followed by OPSCAN, pentacam, Cirrus, and Corvus will give you the least pachymetry. So when you are comparing, say, a patient you have done previously pachymetry on OPSCAN, now you are doing it on Corvus, if the device variability in itself is, say, 20-30 microns, you cannot consider that to be progression. For OPSCAN showed last time 450 and now Corvus shows 420, does not mean that the patient has progressed, just that these devices have a fixed variability. And if you look at the other, that was all on normal eyes. If you look at it in keratoconic eyes, the same three devices, pentagam, Galilee, and Cirrus, you will find that these machines have a different reading for each of these parameters that are measured, and that they cannot be used interchangeably. So one patient you have measured on pentagam, next time he comes back, you do his keratometry on Galilee, and then you cannot say comparing the two keratometries that this patient has progressed, because these values differ by a fixed number between the devices. And when we compared the repeatability between the three devices, we found that pentagam and Cirrus were having better repeatability than Galilee in keratoconic eyes. And when you look at the values of what these devices show, if you look at these values, which are the test reader's repeatability, based on this repeatability numbers, we'll be able to find out what is the progression indication in each of these devices. So if pentacam is showing you more than two different readings that are 0.5 diopter variability, it is considered progression in according to pentacam. But for the same patient to have progression in Galilee, it has to be a more than 0.6 to 0.75 diopters difference. So you cannot have a standard criteria for progression for keratoconus or post-oslinking. It has to be based on the devices that you are using. And if you are looking at this article, we initially found out that OPSCAN had a very poor repeatability for normal eyes and Galilee had a poor repeatability in keratoconus eyes. But if you look at this article, which compared the repeatability and agreement in post-cross-linking eyes, which have a haze, because these devices are adjusted for the refractive index of the cornea, and if you have a different refractive index because of haze or edema, your repeatability of the device changes. So in these situations, if you specifically look at, our findings were finally that Galilee had the best repeatability in post-cross-linking eyes. So if you have a predominantly keratoconus practice, you're doing a lot of topo-guided PRKs, lot of higher order aberration treatments, lot of post-cross-linking patients follow-up, then Galilee is a better device to have, because the repeatability of Galilee is better. And that is because of having two Scheinflug cameras. So in the same one rotation of the Scheinflug camera, you have two cameras in Galilee which have a better capturing of the device quality image based on the, even if in the presence of a haze. And compared to even pentacam, OPSCAN had a better keratometric repeatability when you look at post-haze eyes. And pentacam had a poorer repeatability compared to even OPSCAN and Galilee. And this is to compare the accuracy of the devices for being able to detect keratoconus. So this is a paper in AJO, and if you look at, we found out the actual indices which are in pentacam, Corvus, pentacam, Galilee and Cirrus, as to which indices have the highest sensitivity and sensitivity and specificity for the diagnosis of keratoconus from a normal patient and diagnosis of suspect from a normal patient. To distinguish, these indices had the best specificity and sensitivity in the devices. So for each of the users of these devices, it is a must to know which indices they have to look at for different scenarios. If you want to look at in Galilee which indices is best for detecting a suspicious cornea from a normal cornea, you have to use CSI and OSI. Whereas if it is the same thing for detecting a keratoconus from a normal, differentiating, you have to look at PPK and SRI and IAI. And similarly for Cirrus, though Cirrus is not the primary area of interest at this point of time, but we are showing you the indices which have to be checked for best sensitivity and specificity for these conditions. And if you look at which is the best device, for example, you have 100 patients of keratoconus diagnosed on pentacam based on BAT-D, how many of them were actually detected to be suspects or keratoconus in Galilee and Cirrus? So for differentiating between a normal and a keratoconic eye, you have similar levels of statistical diagnostic accuracy when you compare BAT-D and the Galilee and the Cirrus indices. But if you look at in a problem, when you have a situation of differentiating between subclinicals and normals, BAT-D performed the best of pentacam, and next came the Galilee's best index, and then came Cirrus. So if you look at the area under the curve, as it increases, you have better diagnostic accuracy, and the best was with BAT-D. So if you have more of a keratoconus practice, more of a refractive screening practice, the best device to be able to pick up suspects would be your pentacam. And just to have a summary of whatever we have discussed, these four devices were part of our discussion in different papers. So the highlights of each of these devices are, in pentacam, it is premium IOL planning. It is which patient to take in, which patient to not take in for refractive surgery screening. And the only limitation is that it is expensive. And OPSCAN is also as good as pentacam for refractive surgery screening, except for suspect detection. But it is better than all the other devices for white-to-white measurement. And for Galilee, if you look at, it is primarily for planning higher-order aberration corrections and keratoconus management based on higher-order aberrations, and for finding out the corneal wavefront measurements and white-to-white values. And Cirrus since it has a Placido, which is much better in apex detection than other devices, it is used for mammography as well. And if you need to have a summary for a cataract refractive surgeon, so primarily keratoconus screening refractive surgery, I would go with pentacam. If I want to do complex surgeries, I would go with Galilee or pentacam, depending on my availability. And white-to-white, if I have a lot of ICL surgeries, I would go in with OPSCAN. And if I want to also have a excimer laser linked to the OPSCAN, I would go in with Bausch & Lomb Tineo. And for biometry, I would go with pentacam, pentacam AXL or Galilee. And if I have a predominantly post-cross-linking haze kind of patients and more of patients with corneal changes with respect to refractive index, I'll go for Galilee first. So I thank you for all the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Vaidish. Probably I can say you are one of the number one in India who can give this kind of message. Big hats off to him, big claps around. Probably even for me, really eye-opener. I think before you leave to Canada, I think we have to involve you. We have to take out a lot of stuff out of you in India because most of the society has to be invited to you because you know such a knowledge. So I just wanted to ask you, like you're telling about Corvis and what about the Corvis? Do you have or like where you have to? Actually, you have to buy that, whether you require, because people say that someone has got a astigmatism, like that helps in, what is your opinion about Corvis?
So, Corvis, if you have a predominantly high-end refractive surgery screening practice where you deal with a lot of suspects and your pentagram is giving you suspicious ranges of results and indices, in those cases, your biomechanics from Corvis will help a lot. And if you also have a glaucoma practice where you're dealing with a lot of post-refractive surgery patients, you have more of IOP variations based on corneal thickness and biomechanics. In those situations as well, Corvis will be of definite use. And pre-refractive surgery, the newer indices that are showing up in Corvis, we are still comparing that with ultrasuccal findings in the cornea. But if you have a high-end refractive practice where you have a lot of suspects, you want to decide between PRK or SMILE or LASIK, in those situations, your Corvis indices will help you a lot.
See, we have been practicing refractive surgery last 8 years, but I don't have pentacam. I don't have ARP scan. I am having a machine called Atlas Topographer from Zeiss, which is connected to the Visante OCT. That I think both it calculate and give both anterior and posterior. What is your take-home message? Still it's old one or can we go ahead with that equipment?
No, sir. The Atlas Placido has a special feature of cone configuration in the center that though it is a Placido, it has a very high level of central corneal keratometric values that it takes compared to the Placido and other devices. So your Atlas Topographer is as good as a topographer compared to your pentacam or Galilee for your central corneal power. And it can be also used in post-corneal refractive, post-keratorefractive surgeries because even your ACRS calculator gives you options of entering your Atlas powers, because which is available only with pentacam EKR map. The similar accuracy has been found with your Atlas maps as well. The only disadvantage you would have with the Atlas Topographer compared to these are the ability to interpret your aberrations in the cornea, which is not of great significance for people who don't do wafer guided treatment or high-end topographic treatment. So it is definitely, when you have a combination with an excimer which can help in the same purpose, it's as a batch, you can buy it, and it's definitely as accurate as pentacam or Galilee.
When it is connected, because when I buying the Melity machine, then I was talking to Rohit Shetty. He said that if Zeiss can provide you Atlas Topographer with Visante OCT, both combined together give the printout, that is probably as accurate as pentacam or better. Because what I have observed, especially for corneal thickness, because I got a couple of clinic, one in Mangalore, which has got a new topographer from Visionex. So before Visionex only used to manufacture for Atlas Remedio. Now they bought Remedio. But Visionex, the whatever the thickness it gives, then when you come to with the topography with the Visante, always 20 micron less. So it gives much lesser thickness. As far as the patient is concerned, whatever the machine gives, as less as possible, it's good for the patient.
So depending on, we need to know the accuracy of each and every machine that is commonly in use so that we know, we don't interpret the raw numbers or the values that the machine gives blindly, but we know how each device's vacuometry, keratometry correlates to the other device so that we don't make false interpretations.
One question, Vaidish. You said the ob scan was better when it comes to calculating the white to white. Although, I mean, there is a Placido and a scheme plug even in the other two machines. How does it differ? Why is there a difference?
So white to white calculation is based on a particular part of the iMetric software which measures the horizontal visible iris diameter. So when you have devices which have iMetric software which has a better repeatability and which has better ability to detect the edge of the horizontal vertical iris diameter, then it gives you better representation of the white to white. Whereas if you look at pentacam or Galilee, it's not a directly calculated value from iMetrix. In pentacam, you'll have to go to the actual root of the scleral spur and then measure your white to white from there. So when you do it manually, your repeatability and reproducibility goes down. And the iMetrix software, when it is actually incorporated properly in the same way it has to be done, then the accuracy goes up.
I'm basically using the Pentacam AXL with a Corvis. So for my cataract evaluation, as well as for my keratoconus screening and for my refractive. So what I have noticed that the I mostly rely on the TBI instead of CBI, and but I have seen sometimes this Corvus, it overestimates the situation. So you might need to exclude many cases, particularly the suspicious cases. So how do you comment about that?
So currently the issue is TBI, CBI are all calculated based on European ice, and their corneal thicknesses, their biomechanics vary slightly from the Indian ice. So even in spite of having a normal biomechanics, those suspicious corneas in Asian eyes may be excluded as suspicious because they don't fall in line with the European eyes. So what we actually are doing currently is that this area of study is still, we need to correlate between the ultrastructural properties of the cornea through, you know, collagen measurements and correlate it with the Corvus and Pentacam. So we are currently working on a study to find out which of these indices, say between Corvus, between Pentacam and the actual collagen measurements in the cornea, how do they correlate to give us which is the best index we need to find out when we do a screening. So we'll be out with the results in a few months. So until then, it is best not to use TBA alone. So when you consider other parameters, we find your cornea is absolutely stable, topographic symmetry is really good, corneal thickness is good, and biomechanics deflection amplitude is okay. And if you still find TBA is slightly borderline, for want of doubt, you can still go ahead with the PRK or a smile extra or a LASIK extra. But that is only a, you know, sense of security for the surgeon. But we never know what exactly is happening because the database for comparison is different between Indian eyes and European eyes.
Don't you think that the best decision making should be on the basis of the BAD-D at this particular point of time?
No, sir. BAD-D is at this point of time definitely yes. But with the newer artificial intelligence systems coming up and the ultrastructural findings coming up, we may soon be able to replace that with a slightly better index.
Good morning, everybody. Now, from the cornea, we move on to the lens. And I'll be speaking about the lens-based procedures for presbyopia. I'll skip the initial, definitions for what presbyopia is and what the surgical principles are to correct the presbyopia. Basically, when you come to lens-based procedures to correct presbyopia, we either have monovision, multifocal or trifocal, increased depth of focus or extended depth of focus, and a combined approach and pseudo-accommodation in some of the lenses. So when it comes to LASIK, corneal-based procedures, it's either LASIK, that's presby-LASIK, presbyond or monovision, or inlays. Or supracore or intracore. I have not much of an experience in corneal-based procedures, so I'll stick to the lens ones. So the whole idea of using a lens-based procedure to correct presbyopia is to replace the normal crystalline lens. But can an IOL do the same lens as the natural crystalline lens? Not really, but we are actually trying to get very close to that. So with the lens refractive surgery, that is when you're trying to remove a normal or a clear crystalline lens which has just lost its accommodative capacity. So now because phacoemulsification has become so repeatable and so successful, now this lens-based procedures are gaining more success or demand as compared to the corneal-based procedures, because corneal-based procedures are still might have to be repeated after a few years. And here in lens-based procedures, we can give something called a finality. So when it comes, first option would be monovision. In monovision, what we're really trying to do is we correct the dominant eye for distance, try and make it absolutely emmetropic, and then you put another monofocal lens in the non-dominant eye and make that eye myopic by between 2 to 2.5. That is again a question of a discussion and argument as to how much of myopia do you induce in the non-dominant eye. But this monovision thing is not always a smooth adaptation or a smooth sail, because if you make a patient sit in your OPD and give emmetropia for distance and myopia for the other eye and ask the patient to move around for a bit or look around for a bit, not all patients accept this. So such patients have to be weeded out, and monovision would not be an option for these kind of patients. Next, coming to multifocal IOLs, yes, multifocal IOLs have been there for a very long time, and as opposed to what we think, because it's been there since about 1982. That's a very long time. So here in multifocal, what we really did is, it's a single IOL with more than one focal point. That is two focal points in multifocal and three focal points in trifocal. So initially what came in was the refractive multifocals. They didn't do too well, especially in the Indian eyes and the smaller pupils. And because of the senile meiosis, these refractive IOLs didn't do weren't too popular in the Indian eyes. That's because each of the zones was stipulated to do a certain job at a certain light level. So that a certain power is given to a certain light level and a certain pupil size. So because the pupil size is not comparable between person to person, this will not be repeatable in every patient. So next came diffractive IOLs. Diffractive IOLs, it utilizes the principle of diffraction. Basically, the basic refractive power is provided from the anterior surface, and the diffraction comes from the multiple grooves that are there on the posterior surface. Here, what happens is you're creating two focal points, and in the refractive, although there were only two focal points, those two focal points were too fuzzy. But in a diffractive one, the focal points became more clearer and more definable. So what exactly does a diffractive IOL do? Diffraction is basically the bending of light when it hits the obstruction. So when you have two obstructions here, the spherical wave progression, as the Huygens-Fresnel principle, there is constructive interference that happens when we have multiple edges or multiple grooves on the posterior surface of the IOL, and when these add up, that they come to make two focal points. So there are some lenses which give you plus 3.5 add, some lenses which give you 2.5, some lenses which give 1.5 add. So how do we actually make it? It depends on the width and the height of the groove that you make. So the shorter the width, the higher the add power. The shorter the width means that it's wider. So the wider the width, if the width of the groove is shorter, the addition power is higher, and if the width of the groove is wider, then the additional power is lower. So an apodization was kind of a marketing from a certain IOL company, which became very popular. Basically, what they're actually doing is the innermost ring has the highest step height, and the height gradually reduces towards the periphery. And because the transition between these two grooves are made very smooth, and they called it apodization, which was later used in almost all IOLs which came after that. So although multifocal IOLs gave good distance vision and near vision, intermediate vision was always a problem. And because intermediate vision is used in most of our daily life, especially when you're driving, when you have to look at the meters that is in front of you, or when you're using a desktop, so the lack of intermediate vision, we had to make some annoying modifications in our lifestyle, and not many patients were really happy about it. And that is when the trifocal IOLs came in. In trifocal IOLs, as opposed to bifocals, what happens is each groove is again divided into two. So what happens is we are creating three focal points. So if there is one groove, you cut it down into two, and one is for a certain additional power. For example, I have much experience with the AT-LISA tree, wherein the near addition is about 3.3, that is for a comfortable reading distance, and an intermediate addition of 1.66. So this significantly improves the intermediate vision without compromising much of near. Yes. Will there not be more light loss when you're creating more grooves and more interference? Of course, it has to. But then they say there is something called smooth transition technology and very ununderstandable jargon. But when it comes to practicality, when you ask the patient if they are really worried about the contrast sensitivity loss that they're having because of lower light, most of them don't complain. So next came, so that was with the trifocal lens. Next, now the most popular lenses that happens in our practice is the extended depth of focus lens. Extended depth of focus is a good compromise between the benefits of monofocal and the disadvantages of multifocal. So it gives you more spectacle independence as compared to the monofocal, but fewer side effects. So herein, we cannot actually promise the patient absolutely glass-free vision, but you could say 90% of their day would go without the need for glasses, unless they have to look at extremely fine print, they might need glasses. I mean, we usually give them a 1.5 additional glasses to keep with them when they walk around, and only when they need it, they tend to use it. Herein, there is no creation of two focal points. What is really happening is the bike, the herein the, we have a biconvex wavefront design anterior aspheric surface and a posterior achromatic diffractive surface. So it creates an achromatic diffraction pattern which elongates the single focal point. That's the catch here. It doesn't create two focal points. It is actually elongating the single focal point. So it doesn't work on diffraction here. It actually works on chromatic interference. So this is again a proprietary to Zeiss, which I am very comfortable using, or the only lens that I use or read off. So there is something called, here in the intermediate addition is about 1.9, that is for about 70 centimeters, and far intermediate about 0.95. Here, one thing that we have to note is there is no real addition for near. So this with this line, what many would think is then they should not have any near vision at all. I mean, you know, it's only far and intermediate, but not so. Most of the patients that who come back, and practically when we ask them, like, you know, how they are able to lead their life, they would say most of their near activity is done without glasses. Only few of them really need glasses even after read off, and these patients have absolutely no glare. So I won't go into the surgical video. It's just a phaco and an IOL insertion. Next, the another option for treating presbyopia is patients who have already had had a monofocal in their eye. You can give them a sulcoflex multifocal or a phakic IOL multifocal. Or there used to be a phakic IOL multifocal which came in as a presbyopic option but didn't stand ground for too long. And then astigmatism treatment when it comes to presbyopic IOLs is extremely important, because if you leave behind a 0.75 astigmatism after putting in a multifocal, that will be disastrous. This is the kind of blur that they will have. This is a simulated blur that was being able to achieve. This is about 0.5 and this is about 0.75. Absolutely unacceptable. So angle kappa, again, it is a good tool to know, but then sometimes we tend to overdo things when it comes to science. According to me, most of the patients, at least 90 to 95% of the patients, even without calculation of an angle kappa, have had absolutely no complaints. I think we are doing a little overkill here when it comes to angle kappa. But one thing to keep in mind is in extreme hyperopes or people who have already undergone LASIK for hyperopic refractive error needs to be checked for angle kappa, and most of the others will go smooth even if we don't do it. So, and then asphericity on multifocals. Asphericity on multifocals, I think, is a sham, because they're actually inducing spherical aberrations and chromatic aberrations here in EDOF and multifocals. And if you say the anterior surface is aspheric and you're inducing aberrations with the posterior surface, it doesn't really make sense. So the most important practical consideration when it comes to preoperative assessment is a strong urge for spectacle independence. Do not push patients to go for a presbyopia correcting IOL unless the patient really asks you for it. And then, of course, I mean, you know, pre-existing ocular pathologies have to be looked into, because these are premium IOL patients. They pay a lot of money, so the expectations definitely go up. Hypercritical patients, again, if they ask you too many questions, too demanding, and if they keep asking you, are you sure, do you guarantee me spectacle-free vision? No, I mean, you know, these are patients who are not fit to undergo multifocal. You can just weed them out by saying maybe your eye doesn't allow you to have a multifocal and just avoid them. Night activity, yes, everybody keeps talking about glare. And, you know, if you go to a multifocal session or any symposia, they keep overemphasizing about how much glare that the patient will have after a multifocal IOL. I would say, yes, there is definitely some glare, but then this is not something that you cannot live with. So most usually patients after about 3 to 6 months get used to it. But then night activity, if it is too much, that is, if it's a professional driver or has night driving every single day for more than about 10 kilometers, then probably no. But then if you are carrying out, I drive in the twilight, but then not too much in the night, but I'm not a professional driver, I have a driver with me, still you can go in with a multifocal. Intraoperative exclusion criteria, especially vitreous loss. Most of these patients have already paid you money.
So, I mean, you know, you have that mental barrier or that kind of an, you know, situation, catch-22 situation that you might have to put a multifocal even if the patient doesn't really achieve what you have actually promised them. Please do not do it. You can actually counsel the patient better. You put in a monofocal, give the patient good distance vision, and like, you know, probably single eye multifocal is also an option. I mean, you know, that is again a discussion that keeps happening, single eye multifocal IOLs, even that is an option. Previous refractive surgery, to do multifocal or not to do multifocal, again, I mean, you know, I at this point of time, I'm not comfortable to do a multifocal in a LASIK or a smile eye, but maybe, I mean, you know, in time I might change. Accurate biometry, yes, I mean, I think this is a completely different topic altogether. I think I'll skip and not talk too much about it. When it comes to a power calculation, just one point that I want to put in is, if it is it is always best to use an online calculator rather than depend on the formulae that are already incorporated in your optical biometer. Another question comes up is, like, you know, I do not have an optical biometer, still can I practice presbyopia correcting IOLs? Of course you could, but then multiple measurements using an immersion scan will definitely give you as close to. And then using these methods to calculate the variables and then putting these variables on into the online calculator and calculating can maximize your outcomes. Post-operative refractive target, yes. If it is monofocal, a slight amount of myopia would be ideal in the non-dominant eye. Even multifocals, I mean, if with a +3 add, the desired refraction should be exactly zero or nearly, or the nearest plus. But in EDOF lenses, it is best to make one eye emmetropic for distance and other eye up to -0.75 myopia. But all this has to be discussed with the patients beforehand and not give the patient any surprises. Of course, surgical technique has to be spot on when you are considering presbyopic IOLs. There are disadvantages because the light intensity is cut, so the contrast sensitivity is definitely lesser. But like I told you earlier, the practical outcomes or day-to-day living is not greatly affected. Off-axis aberrations, yes. I mean, you know, if there is an anterior capsular phimosis which moves the IOL by about 1 millimeter from the axis of the center of the pupil, it could have some amount of, glare. Bilateral summation, yes. You always tell the patient. I mean, if the patient is unhappy, or like, you know, if the patient says, I have not achieved maximum vision that you had promised after I did my first IOL, always tell the patient it would definitely get better after you do the second eye. Neural adaptation, if the patient is unhappy about the kind of vision that the patient is getting, you have to explain to the patient that the brain is not used to these kind of images till date. This is a kind of a new image that the IOL is sending in. It will take some time for the brain to adapt. So in conclusion, I think lens-based procedures for presbyopia are superior to cornea-based procedures because it gives finality. EDOF is a good balance between monofocal and multifocals and present favorite that is there. Glare and halos, although they are there, shouldn't be overemphasized at this point of time. Thank you.
Dr. Chinnappa, anytime you have to explant the multifocal IOLs because of the glare and other problems? Yeah, I have done in almost 3 or 4 patients. So since then, I'm very guarded, very cautious about. I waited for 3 months, but still, patient kept on saying that I'm not able to drive at night. There's a lot of glare and all that, and so finally, I had to put a monofocal. No, I've not done others like I said.
As you said, at this point of time, you're not interested putting any multifocal IOLs in this segment of post-refractive eyes. Can you not think about the EDOF in future? Because that gives less glare and halos and all these.
With the EDOF lenses coming in, we have more confidence to put in multifocal IOLs in patients with post-refractive surgery. But then again, calculation of these IOLs, there's a small problem when it comes to these lenses. Because when I last checked, the online calculator, the ACRS calculator, didn't have an option for an EDOF lens.
at that point of time. So I wasn't sure if I'm calculating the right power of lens. So I stepped back a bit.
Like now we have newer formulas like Barrett-Trucke formula, particularly for the post-refractive, when the change in the posterior cornea is much, you know. So you can use all this Barrett-Trucke, all these latest generation formulas. So you may not be worried about the toricity or the defocus also in these cases.
When you go on and choose these formulas, this IOL A constant wasn't there on the online calculator when I last checked. So that is why I stepped back a bit.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Now we have a wide spectrum of refractive surgery that is available to us. So starting with surface ablation, LASIK, and that has progressed to customized treatment. Then came the femtolasic, and now ultimately we have the SMILE, the most advanced treatment. So it all started with in the early 90s, where PRK became a common technique worldwide to correct low to moderate myopia. But with the advancement in the technology and the machine, we started to offer a wider treatment range and more predictable and stable results. So PRK is done basically for your regular refractive errors like hyperopia and myopia. And in cases where you have a thinner corneas and to correct residual refractive error following keratoplasty and also to do top-up correction after any refractive surgery. So the standard PRK treatment involves the removal of epithelium first, either with mechanical scraping, brush, 20% alcohol, or Excimer laser itself. So in LASIK and epiLASIK, basically you don't remove the epithelium totally, you replace it. In LASIK, you loosen the epithelium with 20% alcohol, and once you do the treatment, you place it back. In epiLASIK, you lift a sheet of the epithelium with the microkeratome, do the treatment, and place it back. But overall, the surface ablation still has some concerns like variable results, longer duration for visual recovery, and haze, which basically is contributed by the primary activation of the keratocytes into fibroblast, which is initiated by a lack of contact with the epithelium above. So if you can intervene where there is rapid healing of the epithelium and you can regulate the keratocyte activation, these complications can be reduced. So post-operative haze usually is seen after a few weeks or months after the procedure. Generally, within 9 months to 1 year, it resolves on its own, even without treatment, with restoration of normal keratocytes and replacements of the abnormal extracellular matrix. But if it doesn't resolve, you can use high-potent steroids and do the PTK treatment and then apply MMC for a minute or so. So now the role of MMC after PRK has become really invaluable. The thumb rule is you use it for 10 seconds for every diopter of correction. And for secondary procedure, you have to apply it for a minute or so. One of the major drawbacks of PRK is high degree of postoperative pain. So this pain is typically moderate to severe and usually peaks 24 to 48 hours after the surgery and resolves once the epithelium heals. Dr. Rohit Shetty and et al. Have described a very novel technique where they use BCL-soaked preservative-free ketorolac and it is applied over the cornea after the treatment. What this does is the results are really fantastic. Pain is not there in the right immediately after the next day itself, and the epithelium would have healed up to 90 to 95% itself. So patient is really happy next day. So we have started incorporating this in our practice too. And most of the surgeons have started doing this. Coming to LASIK, LASIK is one of the most commonly performed elective surgery in the medicine field. You can do the flap either by using a microkeratome or with the femto laser. But there are issues with the microkeratome like the flap tear, buttonholing, free caps. So if you do the flap using the femtosecond laser, here the laser is directed at the certain corneal depth in a spiral or raster pattern to achieve a planar corneal flap. As compared to your LASIK flap, it's most of the time it's a menisci flap, where the central corneal thickness, central cornea is a thinner one, and in the periphery it's a thicker one. In the planar flap, you have a regular corneal thickness right from the center to the periphery. So the advantage of the femtol assay car, it gives a very predictable uniform flap, rate of dry eye is very less, and it can be safely done in both the flatter and the steeper corneas. But again, there are a few issues with the femtol assay, like it can cause opaque bubble layer during the treatment, which can later obstruct your eczema laser application. There might be sometimes transient light sensitivity to the patient after the procedure due to corneal haze, and also the overall duration of the treatment is also increased because you have to move the patient from one station to other after creating the flap. Coming to the SMILE procedure, SMILE is the most recent advanced state-of-art femtosecond technology, where a precision lenticule is created in the corneal stroma, which is then removed via a minimal incision. So basically, it is a no ablation treatment. It's a single step laser, no need to move from one station to other, and the patient has a very early recovery. Even with such an advanced treatment, you have few issues with SMILE too, like the astigmatism correction is still not very accurate. There is no cyclotorsion compensation. There is no hypermetropic treatment. And you don't have the option to do a customized treatment in the patient, if at all you are planning to do. So now let us compare each of the treatment with each other and let's see how they fare. Well, if you compare the vision quality, in LASIK, in most of the time, due to cosine effect, the real optic zone that you get after the treatment is generally lesser than the intended optical zone. But that's not the case in SMILE. So what you plan is what you get in SMILE. That's why the vision quality is that really good after the SMILE procedure as compared to LASIK or PRK. Again, higher order aberration induction and spherical aberration is very less in SMILE as compared to LASIK and PRK. If you take contrast sensitivity, again, the results are mixed here, where a few papers or studies have said that contrast sensitivity post LASIK is less as compared to SMILE. But at end of 9 months to 1 year, the contrast sensitivity is the same both in SMILE and LASIK. So what about the corneal curvature changes after the treatment? So well, in SMILE, the corneal curvature changes is very well maintained. You don't see very rapid change in the corneal curvature after the treatment. Well, in LASIK, especially with the higher refractive error correction, there is greater corneal curvature changes in the treatment. That induces even more spherical aberrations. Coming to the post-operative refractive stability, the refractive stability is very much greatly retained after the SMILE as compared with your LASIK or your PRK, because the amount of inflammation and stromal remodeling is very much less in SMILE as compared to your eczema treatment. Again, if you see the regression, the amount of regression after SMILE is very less, because the stromal remodeling and the whatever the epithelial thickening that you see after your LASIK and PRK, it's not seen in SMILE at all. That's why the regression is very less, even in higher treatment correction in SMILE. So coming to the inflammation part, as I said earlier, with higher refractive error correction, more energy spots have to be delivered to the cornea in LASIK or PRK. That's why the ultimate inflammation induced is much more. But that's not the case with SMILE. The energy delivered is constant, independent of the refractive error here. So that's why the inflammation is very less. There is early tissue healing and early recovery. Coming to the dry eye, the impact on the corneal surface is very less in SMILE because the amount of nerves transected is very less as compared to LASIK. Coming to the corneal biomechanics after the treatment, so by design, SMILE is very much better and the corneal integrity is very much well maintained as compared to your LASIK. The LASIK flap doesn't contribute to the overall strength of the cornea after the treatment. That's why the corneal biomechanics is very much affected after LASIK. In SMILE, if you see, the tissue evacuation happens in a much deeper plane than the away from the stronger anterior stroma. So this also contributes to the overall maintaining of the corneal integrity after the treatment. So if you see, in the myopic correction, SMILE treatment still has the upper hand. But if you see if you consider treatments like hyperopic treatment, astigmatism, and retreatment, LASIK and PRK still have a greater role. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hari. So just to take home message, I think if you are treating a very high cylinder, suppose the patient has got a 4.5 cylinder with the 0.5 or minus 1 diopter of refractive error, the preferred choice always should go for a femtolasic than SMILE. That's what we observed. Initially, we used to do SMILE. We suppose if the patient is having like up to 4.5 diopters, normally we need to add some amount of spherical equivalent to that and treat the patient. But the overall regression rate will be slightly higher in SMILE compared to femtolasic. In such cases, I think femtolasic is the best option for them. So we need to pick up the case, okay, which is the best for the patient. And if you really wants to do PRK also, your mitomycin C management is also very important, depending upon the geographical distribution. See, I practice in a place which is a coastal area. Because the UV exposure to the eye is much higher than compared to you are practicing in a different part of my state. So my mitomycin C management is something little bit more than the other places. So you may have to put mitomycin C for more number of seconds compared to the other geographical area. Along with that, even what I just wanted to say, even post-op treatment, like if you do PRK in a different area where there is not that much exposure to the UV light, even if you put a treatment for 1.5 months of low potent steroid is sufficient. But if you are, depending upon your occupation and where you are staying, then probably that area you may have to put the treatment for a period of 3 months. What do you feel, Vaidesh?
So we follow only for 6 weeks, and we also, apart from using mitomycin, we also check patients' vitamin D levels because that also contributes to corneal haze. So maintaining vitamin D levels, patients' allergy, IgE levels have to be under control. And with that, if we apply appropriate MMC application, and for in our zone area, Bangalore, which is not coastal and it's not the, so we usually give for 4 to 6 weeks depending on the patient, and our haze rates are very, very minimal.
Paying gratitude to Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu for training us. If you don't know, just to let you know that he visited Bangladesh and trained our doctors. So he is our teacher in a SMILE. So just like to ask you about a SMILE. Just before coming, there was an anisometropia case. On the right eye, it was minus 5 spherical, but the left eye was minus 1.25 cylinder at 25 degree. So I corrected it because patient wanted a SMILE in both eyes, but spherical addition was minus 0.5. We added it during. So I mean, I have not followed the patient. So did I do any mistake?
Actually, in this particular case, suppose if you have got a one eye of minus 1.25 cylinder, if you are adding spherical component for that, then my preferred treatment in this particular patient, 0.5 sphere and reduce the cylinder from 1.5 to 1. That compensate overall to 1.25. Don't make it totally 1.25. Make it around 1 cylinder in this case. Suppose if the patient is having 3.25 cylinder, then you put 3.25 or 3 cylinder only. Since your astigmatism is very less, if you do 0.5 with 1.25, sometimes you may have a 0.25 over correction. That is my overall this year experience.
What could be the minimum power in a SMILE we can correct for, whether it's sphere or cylinder?
Minus 1 we can correct, provided you have to keep the lenticule thickness more. Once again, depending upon your surgical hands. If you are very confident of identifying the layer in one shot with the slow dissection, with minus 1 also you can do, with even a minimum lenticule thickness of 50 micron. But once again, depending upon, there is nothing wrong in increasing the lenticule thickness for minus 1 because your residual stromal thickness is going to be more. So you can increase the lenticule thickness more and, you can increase more. So then there is not going to be have any problem. Only thing is identifying the proper layer is very, very important. Minus 1 also you can do. overall optic zone also you have to increase. Thank you. So we have got one more join in refractive surgery, none other than Dr. Satyamurthy from central part of Karnataka, India. He'll be talking. He's very much expert in treating a lot of keratoconus patients. He'll be talking about the CXL in typical and atypical scenarios.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. KP, and thanks for giving me this opportunity. So collagen crosslink, as we all know, is one modality where we can arrest the further progression of the keratoconus or any ectasis of the cornea. Since a lot of general ophthalmologists are also doing this procedure, it's better to have a clear idea, but unfortunately the corneal surgeons are more here. So we know that there is disorganization of the fibrils of the anterior lamellae, so thereby the ectasia and the thinning is more common. And we all know that the crosslinks are less, that's why this cornea becomes weaker, and as the crosslinks are increased, it becomes little more stiffer like this. This is the animal porcine experiments, and you see these crosslinks which have to be increased. So now what is the thing? We need a photo inducer. So this is riboflavin, and then that is irradiated by the ultraviolet light, that UVA. And so what exactly happens here is a singlet oxygen, the nascent oxygen is released. So that results in the formation of this collagen, these crosslinks between the collagen fibrils. And the indication, since keratoconus is the most common ectatic disorder, so any progressive keratoconus, where the earlier it used to be like this, where the thickness is more than 400, and one should be able to improve the vision with the contact lens, and the patient should have a clear cornea, is a good candidate. So the Dresden protocol includes where your this is the conventional way of treating the cornea with the collagen cross-linking. 9 mm of the epithelium is removed, and then riboflavin 0.1% is instilled every 3 minutes for a half an hour, and then irradiation continues for about 30 minutes, where again riboflavin is instilled every 5 minutes, and after that bandage contact lens is placed. At the end of 2 weeks, after 2 weeks, we see this demarcation line, which indicates that is between the cross-linked and non-cross-linked area. It is usually at a 300 micron range. That means it's a good, well cross-linked area. And then the what exactly are the clinical outcome? The reduction in of the maximum K value by 1 to 2 diopters, and the stability over a period of 4 years. I mean, as you will have to keep on monitoring these patients, and then there will be gain of about 1 to 2 lines sometimes because of the reduction in the K value, and they can be low to moderate haze up to 6 months, and then later on it will dissolve with the repopulation of the keratocytes. But sometimes it can progress after the thing also, like in case if there is a progression after 1 year, or the corneal thinning continues, or there is a keratometric documented progression, then one has to think of retreating. So this is exactly what happens, is after the treatment with the collagen cross-linking, there is reduction in the steepness of the cornea because it stabilizes, and there's improvement of about 1 to 2 diopters, and this is the difference map that you're seeing. Now, what are the advances that have been taking place is, see, the Dresden protocol, which is conventional, it takes about 1 hour. So half an hour soaking and half an hour treatment with the sitera. So the time is very precious. So to correct that, I mean, to get more time, I mean, we can do the rabbit procedure based on this particular principle, that Munsen and Roscoe law of reciprocity, where the photochemical reaction is directly proportional to the total irradiation dose irrespective of the time taken. But the studies show that anything more than 45 milliwatts per centimeter square, or anything irradiation less than 2 minutes, is not going to be helpful. And the studies show that the 3 millimeters and 9 millimeter, the conventional, and then at 9 millimeters, it is going to be good. Others are still contradictory. Advantages are known. It shortens the procedural time, and all the patient discomfort and all these things are mitigated. The other modifications that we have is want to have the epithelium off or epithelium on. With the epithelium off, we know our advantages are that the absorption of riboflavin is much better here because of the removal of the epithelium, the tight junctions are gone. But there are disadvantages like patient has a discomfort, there can be haze, there can be infection, there can be stromal melt, and there can be persistent epithelial defect also. So to avoid that, what if we can keep the epithelium on without removing epithelium, but the absorption of riboflavin is poor, and thereby the cross-linking is much less, and keratoconus is likely to progress. So what we can do, there are some people have tried all sorts of things like partial grid pattern of epithelial development and eczema laser removal of the epithelium over only the 5 millimeter zone, but still not useful. And then you devitalize the epithelium with chemical enhancers or with 20% alcohol, and then or increase the soak time by 6 to 10, like say contact lens soaked, soaked contact lens, keep it over the cornea for about 90 minutes, and then they use meresol sponge soaked in riboflavin over 5 millimeter area. This and then new one with this trometmol and the EDTA to destabilize the devitalize the epithelium have been tried, and the stromal packets have also been tried. And iontophoresis is one which is promising little better results. The penetration of drug is much better in this, and then the studies which show that the conventional method is still better. And then what about the thin corneas? The problem is here the ultraviolet irradiation may damage endothelium in thinner corneas, so that's why we have to swell it up either with using hyperosmolar agents. Again, the cross-linking is not that good, and we have discussed about epi-on. And then one can use this customized pachymetric guided epithelial development where the epithelium over the thinnest part of the cornea is still retained and still not very effective. Riboflavin soaked bandage contact lens is tried, but because of the difference in the ultraviolet irradiation of the cornea with riboflavin on is not good. And intraoperative augmentation of stromal thickness using the refractive lenticules which we get after doing the SMILE procedure for myopia. People have tried that, and then now the dextran causes more desiccation. That's why the hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose with riboflavin is preferred that people are using in thinner corneas. And then we have this the adapted fluence, which I'm going to explain a little later. So this can also be used along with the LASIK procedure as what we call a LASIK plus, where it is they soaked for about 90 seconds, and then the irradiation with half of the total irradiation dose of about 2.7 joules per joules is used for about 90 seconds. It cannot be used with PRK, it can be used with SMILE, it can where we make the pocket, or it can be that's what the before implanting ICL one can stabilize the thing. And then corneal ectasia following LASIK, this is a post corneal ectasia, still we can stabilize with this. Pediatric cases, the problem is there's a constant eye rubbing, which is supposed to be the main cause here. And even if you do C3R at this stage, unless you control this inflammation and allergy, it is likely to progress, and many patients may require repeat C3R, and then one has to keep these patients under observation. And then corneal infections have also been, people have tried the UV radiation in this, the C3R treatment, which is called the photoactivated chromophore for keratitis. The mechanism is it increases the resistance to enzymatic degradation and prevents microbial replication in that area. And then the singlet oxygen, the reactive oxygen has a direct cytotoxic effect. So thereby, infections can be controlled. Ocular surfaces are rendered hostile to the microbial replication. The success is that they are good in bacterial and acanthamoeba keratitis and less in fungal keratitis, should not be used in HSV keratitis because that gets aggravated And then epithelial healing is better in bacterial keratitis compared to other types of microbial keratitis. And it is good in superficial infections as compared to the deeper infections. And fluorescein should not be used because it competes with the treatment by absorbing the ultraviolet rays. There are newer trends like one can use pulsed cross-linking, basically because this depends on the oxygen availability, and oxygen depletion takes place within 15 to 20 seconds in the initial period, but the re-oxygenation takes about 3 to 4 minutes. So exact period pulses is still one has to decide, and it's in the trial process, and then one can use this customized cross-linking, that is adaptive fluence, where the cross-linking irradiation is done is customized for the customized duration. So the complications can be, there can be infection, which is a dreaded thing, but it's rare. There can be other things like corneal edema, Descemet's membrane folds, which we can manage. But infection is one thing I have seen in two patients where most of the times it is the Staph aureus infection, which responds very well to the vancomycin. So to conclude, it's no doubt it's a non-invasive treatment, and the only one thing which is available for halting the progression of the disease, and it improves the contact lens tolerance, the quick recovery, and avoids corneal grafting probably, and the complications should be kept in mind in most of the infection. Thank you very much.
I'll be just hurrying through my presentation of Press Beyond. I think most of us might have already heard, but why I'm talking repeatedly about the presbyopic surgery, probably it's going to be the market for आपके पास नहीं है सपोर्ट अभी अभी किया है एक मिनट के पहले सपोर्ट कैसे नहीं करेगी डालो इधर ही डाला था ना मैंने I see. Open karo. Sorry for the interruption. So these are the principles to correct presbyopia. As you know that you can do monovision, you can put multifocal intraocular lens like my previous speaker said, or you can think about even increased depth of focus, what we do in camera inlays. So what exactly this laser blended vision, which is a combination of micro monovision and increased depth of focus by using Excimer system, either MEL 80 or MEL 90. So these are the principles. This is very important. It works on the monovision principle. Depth of field to reduce anisometropia, spherical aberration control, vertex centration of spherical aberration, retinal imaging processing, neural submission, followed by blur adaptation, then neural suppression. So what exactly we do? We make the dominant eye emmetropic and make the non-dominant eye myopic by 1.5 diopter. Along with that, we create a controlled spherical aberration in both the corneas. By doing that, we will have a something called blend zone, where the vision from both dominant and the non-dominant eye meets up and binocularity retains. So why we did not pick up this regular multifocal treatment? Normally, if you do a rings in the cornea, brain tend to take images both from the distance and the near vision, and the patient get lot time to get adapt. These are the few problems with presby LASIK we used to do with the some other Alzheimer machine. So if you do with that, normally after probably after 3 years, you may have to repeat the treatment, and patient take a long time to adapt, and they may lose the maximum drop in the contrast sensitivity. So these are few problems with multifocal IOLs. Already Dr. Chinnappa might have enlightened. So what exactly we do? We have to treat both the eye. So always, if the patient is emmetropic also, you have to treat both the eyes for distance and near. So according to my friend Dan Reinstein, 97% of the patient tolerate this treatment. So we have to treat both the eye. So it's very important, especially in your practice, the counseling is so important, because most of the patient require to get rid of their glasses for distance and intermediate vision. So this is about the studies I'm just showing you. I'm not talking about, but how to go about that. Very important is refraction. So when you're doing refraction, lot of optometrists working under me and Dr. Hari, we do the refraction by ourselves. Then try to do cycloplegic refraction for all the patient you are doing presbyopia surgery. This is very important. Then you yourself check the dominant eye of the patient. After you check the dominant eye, then for non-dominant eye, you put 1.5 adapters. Make the myopic by 1.5 adapter. With the same correction on, tell the patient to read for near vision. With the same correction on in the non-dominant eye, tell him to start reading from distance subject. Then patient start reading. If the patient doesn't complain of any cross blur, these are the patient do really well for presbyopia. At least 2 to 3% of the patient, they say that I am having cross blur. Such kind of patient, you can repeat this micromonovision testing. Still there is blur, patient complaining of cross blur. These are the patient, you should not pick them for this particular treatment. Then everything will be decided by the special software system called CRS Master. So surgery I'm not going, because I got a shorter one more speaker to talk. But what I have seen post-operatively after the treatment, you can see here, none of the eyes lost more than half Snellen's line of vision when compared to pre-operative distance visual acuity. So majority of the patient, their functional acuity, the stereo acuity is remained, and very important, we check the patient's contrast sensitivity, it has not been dropped. This is our results. We have done, I think, more than 500 patients in the last 7 years. Only 2 to 3 patients has come back to us with some amount of residual power because of the nuclear changes, but so far you have not treated with any overcorrection. So these are the advantage with this treatment, which is not depend upon the pupil size. You can treat up to hypermetropia up to 5.75 you can stretch, but myopia you can go up to 8.5 diopter depending upon the PACI value, and all my patients have had a very good intermediate and near vision. Thank you one and all. Over to Dr. Sunil. So any time this thing is there, in the end we'll take up the
ने वहाँ पे दिया है
डाउनलोड किया है मेनू इसमें
एक मिनट
ओपन करो सेशन का तुम्हारा किधर रहता है मारी डाल ले मारी
KP. Yeah, we're running out of short of time, so let me finish it off as early as possible. Yeah. So I don't have any financial disclosures. Coming out of the indications wise, probably the ICL and IPCL have got a common indications. Probably if you've got an higher amount of astigmatism, IPCL is a preferred one because you can get a customized lenses. If you've got a presbyopic the K patients, then IPCL is an option for the than the ICL. Both have got an advantages. Both are placed behind the iris in the retro iris plane. Both are sulcus located, gives an excellent quality of vision. The only advantages of IPCL over ICL could be, and it's a cost effective thing. The disadvantages of any phakic IOL, there is a limited space for the surgical procedure. Sometimes you have to resort to a bioptics for higher refractive errors. Hyperopia, probably loss of magnification because of the effect of glasses. And the rare complications like pupil ovalization, uveitis, pupillary block, all these things are associated with both sorts of lenses. When you're looking at the both range of lenses, one should look at the cumulative visual acuity, efficacy, safety, predictability, accuracy, and surgical visual outcomes. These are the three commonly used ICLs and IPCLs which have been in the market. One is from the Star, other is from the Biotech Care Group. Now we have got from the Appaswamy also. The optical diameter of most of these lenses range from 6.5 to 7 mm. The effective optic size is from 4.65 to, it ranges up to 5.8 mm. Overall sizing depends upon the patient's wide-to-wide diameter. The diopter range also quite varies, but you tend to get an customized higher range diopter lenses with the IPCL. The hole in the center of the optics, most of the both ICL and IPCL have got this. There are orientation marks available with both the things. Central thickness, IPCL tends to be a little bit thicker when compared to the conventional ICL lenses. The hyperopic corrections, definitely it's possible with some of the IPCL, both ICLs, but Biotech doesn't have that particular thing. Phakic online calculators are available for the incision size, anywhere range from 2.8 to 3.2 mm, you can use these things. The prerequisites for implanting the IPCL and ICL, you should get these, all these, most critical being the wide-to-wide anterior depth. Along with that, you may require an axial length and the lens thickness for the IPCL insertions. Various methods by which we can use the wide-to-wide measurements. There are difference between the manual and digital calipers, which is around 0.4 mm, whereas the IOL Master gives 0.5 to 0.9 mm more. OPSCAN gives 0.35 mm more than the digital calipers. Deciding on the size, one should look at the both angle-to-angle distance you can look at, or wide-to-wide. To get the proper sizing, there are ready-made charts which are available based on the AC depth and the wide-to-wide diameter, both for the ICL as well as the IPCL. Vault is another critical thing which has to be optimal for both ICL and IPCL to get rid of the complications. Anterior chamber depth. Scotopic pupil size is another thing. The IPCL tends to have a larger optic diameter, tends to have a lesser scotopic thing. But with newer versions of the ICL, with the EVO plus thing, you tend to avoid these problems also with the ICL. Peripheral iridotomy, which used to be earlier required, nowadays with the central hole, it's not required. The shape of the central hole tends to differ from the ICL and IPCL. In ICL, you tend to have a punched out central hole edge, and it's a conical shape in the IPCL. So the loss of diffusion of life, the disturbances are higher in scotopic due to the oblique wavefront than the toric. Of course, you tend to get a marking, any of the custom, the standardized procedures you can use for the marking way you do for the toric IOLs, and you can get a ready-made chart which is available which gives the rotation for the some of the IOLs. But with IPCL, you can get a standard, the 0 to 180 degree mark in a toric IPCLs. Now the presbyopic platform definitely provides multifocal vision, reduces the pupil dependency, balanced distribution of light, able to tolerate some amount of decentrations. These are available with the IPCL. If the age is less than 45 years, monovision is a better option. If age is more than 45 years, put presbyopic IPCL bilaterally. Myopia with presbyopia, better correct undercorrection, aim for an undercorrection. The implantation of presbyopic IPCL is like any other flat plate, foot plate, flat hydrophilic lenses where you put it. Its insertion is similar to that. And so anybody who is comfortable with the foldable IOL techniques can do this presbyopic IPCL also. There is a paper published from the Eye Foundation which compares the IPCL and the ICL efficacy data. If you look at that, IPCL works on par with the ICL with the similar complications. In fact, the complications rate are as good as, less as that of the ICL. And even the rotational stability, the residual refraction at ease, regression, all those things are less with the both are almost on par with the results wise. So the ICL, the main important thing is the loading thing. The rest all the insertion and all are the, similar to that of an IPCL. So the make sure that the loading and the is the most critical thing in an ICL. Once you do that, you should look at the orientation marks and the place the IOL convex or concave so that the, it should not be in the reverse inversion insertion of the IOL. Let me, even the ICL or IPCL can be used as a supplementary IOLs on the pseudophakic lens. For the pseudophakic surprises, you can use both the lenses. Here, the you have to create an the initial lens, if it is a primary location, lens is in the bag, you can use it in the sulcus by creating an sulcus space for the insertion of these lenses. So complications do tend to occur. You tend to develop cataracts, pigment dispersion, elevated IOP, decentration and other things, some inversion of the upside down placement of the IOLs, and even the endothelial cell damage can be occur. Here is the video which showing in a patient with a cataract, the explantation technique of an ICL followed by the routine phaco, where you would go ahead and do the routine phaco. The explantation technique, you can pull the ICL or the IPCL through the same primary clear corneal wound. So it's a very easy procedure and you can get away with the complications, some of the things. But proper sizing and assessing the vault and taking a proper measurements in both the techniques can avoid the complications. That's it. Thank you. Thank you for patient hearing.
Thank you, everybody, for the instruction course. I thank all our instructors. We on time. Over to Dr. Mohita for Women in Ophthalmic Society.